Hi, this is Margaret Byrd, and welcome to Color Quest. And welcome back. A year after I came to the central part of Idaho, I am back here again in this amazing grove of aspen. Now, it is a few weeks later in the season than it was when I was here in 2020. And so the leaves are slightly more mature in their fading for the winter season. This aspen is an incredible sight because of the beautiful shape of their leaves, as well as the white bark, which is so striking against the golden and green background of this region. I am in the Boulder Mountains, which is about 20 miles north of Ketchum, Idaho. We come here every October, my brother and I, to visit a site where we planted a tree in honor of my mom. She and her family lived near here, and we came to this part of the country every year and spent lots of summers and winters enjoying the incredible landscape of the Boulder Mountains. Last year on Color Quest, when I was here, I looked at birch bark as well as evergreen cones that are found in this valley. This year, I thought it would be fun to look at the aspen leaf. I'm going to collect some of these leaves here, bring them back to my studio so that I can look at how they will work in an echo print. I had a video using some local leaves from my area in the summertime, and I know that as leaves mature, the tannins can increase and can change how they interact within an echo print environment. So although I'm going to be testing out an echo print with some fall leaves of aspen, you can do the same at home with so many different kinds of leaves. So go out there, take a little walk in your forest, see what leaves have fallen, different shapes and sizes, and collect some, and let's try out this echo print with fall leaves. So I have returned home from Central Idaho and have gathered leaves here where I live in the Pacific Northwest. I was able to find a few good leaves from different trees in order to add to the mix of aspen leaves that I collected in Idaho. There is a process in echo printing that can result in some pretty vivid color shifts. Tannin and iron interact with one another to create darker tones. And by introducing a tannic rich dye matter with iron, you can create some pretty remarkable prints. I showed this in a previous video I did where I used a tin can as the iron shift, allowing it to interact with the tannins found in the leaves. But this time, I thought it might be fun to try something different. I have been interested in testing out what's known as an iron blanket. An iron blanket is used to go across the echo prints and interact with the tannins of the material you're using. Now, many leaves, hopefully some of the leaves I collected here, have tannins in them. So the interaction between the iron blanket and the leaves should help enhance or create some interesting chemical shifts to the echo print. However, you can also boost it a bit by pre-treating your textile with tannin. So today on Color Quest, I'm going to create a design with the leaves on textile that has been pre-treated with a tannin. We'll be interested to see how that background on the fiber is going to interact as well with the iron blanket. So let's get in there. I've got my leaves and let's try out an iron blanket. By the way, you may hear a lot of children laughing and running about, and that is because tonight it is Halloween and my neighborhood is filled with little ones. So it's a lot of fun to see all the ghosts and goblins running around the neighborhood. Hopefully it's an added sweet sound to the video. iron blanket. Definitely worth trying. I have to admit, I was pretty happy with the results. With echo printing, it can be hit or miss. So I do encourage you to try again and keep testing if the first attempt or the third attempt or the 10th attempt doesn't work. I will tell you that in the short amount of time that I have spent echo printing, I have found that I will get less than happy results. Let's just put it that way. This time, I prepared really well and was careful to make sure that I understood the process, and the iron blanket worked. And I was pretty happy with the results on both the silk and the cotton. Cotton can be tough on echo prints. Silk is typically more forgiving in many ways, especially with natural colors. And so having such an incredible result with the cotton made me really happy. I also thought that the ghost print, if you will, on the iron blanket itself was actually gorgeous. So know that instead of using a pretreatment of tannin on your target fiber, you can also soak your target fiber in iron, and you will get something potentially more like the result that we had as the echo print on the iron blanket itself. I chose to repurpose an old cotton piece of textile. I have a stack of these in my garage that I have saved over the years that I use for rags and different things. This is a perfect way to utilize that by repurposing it. A thicker cotton will hold the iron really well and will most likely provide a more even distribution of the iron. After you use your iron blanket once, rinse it out, you can run it through the wash and just keep them and use them again and again. Now you'll notice that I used a plastic barrier. Please note that this plastic is actually repurposed plastic. It is plastic that I save from shipments of fiber that come to my house. I can use those again and again and again. So I'm not using one use of plastic. If you decide you don't want to use plastic at all, feel free to use paper. I used parchment paper to go on the outer side. You can use this as your barrier piece as well. I did that as an added piece because I will often get a image from the string itself, from the binding string. And although that can be a really pretty design and pattern, I was trying to avoid that. So I put an extra piece of parchment paper around the entire roll in order to try to avoid having those marks. You might like those marks. I've had pieces with those marks on it, and it can add a really beautiful design. I have tried it with brown butcher paper before, recycled from packing material. And unfortunately for me, that has colored or discolored the fiber. The brown of the paper has transferred. So just be aware that that's a possibility. So in this video, I used products that I actually purchased from Botanical Colors, an online shop that has a lot of products available for natural dyeing. The tannin that I used was gallow tannin or oak gall tannin. So if you have oak trees where you live and can collect oak galls, these can be used to make a tannin bath for a mordant. You can also try other kinds of organic matter that you may have. For example, pomegranate skin is one way in which many cultures use to create a tannin bath. I have a video here on Color Quest that shows the process of using pomegranate skins as a tannin mordant. Also, you can look at things like acorns, walnuts. Those can create a very simple way to make a tannin bath. Of course, you can't know the strength of the tannin when you do it that way. I wanted to be able to measure exactly the percentages that I was going to have with my tannin mordant. Same goes with the iron. You'll notice I used ferrous sulfate. Ferrous sulfate is a powdered form of iron that is used in natural dyeing for modifying colors as well as mordants. This is the same idea as what the iron water is that I have used in many videos and shown how to make. The one complaint that people have with using iron water is that you don't actually know your percentages. So you don't have a lot of control. You don't know how strong or weak your iron water may be. So if you like surprises, like I do, by all means, use your iron water. But if you want a little bit more control, as I wanted in this particular video, then you can purchase ferrous sulfate from a company like Botanical Colors. You do have to be cautious with ferrous sulfate. You need to wear gloves to handle it, as well as wear a mask if you are using the powder form so that you're not ingesting it. It is not unsafe if you handle it properly. And that's one of the reasons why I often use iron water, because it is already suspended in liquid and thus there's less likelihood that you're going to inhale it. So if you do choose to use ferrous sulfate in the powder form, just act responsibly, be safe, wash your hands, wash your surfaces. You'll probably notice that I spilled a little bit of the powder and it went onto the tannin prepared material, and just a little bit of that dust already created a blackish pattern to the textile that already had the tannin mordant in it. So it's very powerful stuff. And you'll notice that I used very, very little. And I will take that iron bath that I created and store it in a jar, label it, and I will reuse it. It may not be as strong, but I certainly can add to it and continue to use it more like an iron exhaust bath, if you will. Always be thinking about repurposing. There are many iterations of a particular dye or mordant that you can be repurposing, and you don't just have to throw it down the drain after using it one time. With the success that I feel like I had in the iron blanket, I am now super curious about trying out some different types of blankets. And you can use natural dyes as a dye blanket to transfer another color onto your target fiber. So join me next week on Color Quest as I explore a little bit more with autumn leaves as an echo print, but this time utilizing a dye blanket instead of an iron blanket. I wonder what colors I'll be able to transfer onto my target fiber. If you know of friends who may have interest in joining you in some foraging, some natural dyeing, and some echo printing, tell them about Color Quest. Love this community, love what we're doing, and I can't wait to see you again next Friday. Have a great week. Yeah, that's my shadow. Okay, what else? Still filming.